What's up, guys? This is Manoj Soptani. I welcome you all on behalf of the Edupedia world. It's been a lovely morning today, and I'm sure that you guys are enjoying your day to the fullest, like as usual. Perfect, guys. So, are you like revising your topics time and again? Obviously, you should do, and I'm sure that you guys are doing that. So, guys, this presentation, I'll be talking about a few of the relevant topics related to the Sarbanes-Oxley Act 2002. And this will be the last presentation as far as this particular act is concerned. So, I just hope that you guys must have like pondered and understood the complete provisions which I shared with you in my earlier two presentations with respect to the Sarbanes-Oxley Act 2002. Perfect, guys. So, with this, let's complete and conclude this chapter in this particular presentation itself. Fasten up your seatbelts, we are about to take off with this presentation, with the first topic of the day, and that will be the reporting certifications under Section 404 of SOX Act. So, merely because of the fact, guys, that we all know, SOX is an act, so definitely it will be having some of the provisions as well, some of the sections as well. So, reporting certifications under Section 404 of the Sarbanes-Oxley Act 2002. What does this particular section talks about? Let's understand and focus on that. So guys, this particular section, that is 404, it focuses on the internal control over financial reporting. We are all aware of this fact that in order to run a business, you need to have your financial statements prepared. Running a business is merely a simple kind of an act. Okay, you just need to run a business. Okay, though it involves a lot of complications, I know that running a business is not that easy, correct? But the primary kind of problems, apart from running a business, will also be about the maintenance of that business. Okay, so you need to be aware of the fact that how much revenue did you earn, how much costs have been incurred by now, how much have been your asset, how much have been your equity capital. So, all this requires the financial statements which require to be prepared. Okay. This will form part of your financial reporting, complete financial reporting. Now, since you guys are taking care of the financial reporting, so in order to ensure that whether the kind of things which are happening in order to make and prepare those financial reporting segments are or is the company basically taking care of all the kind of controls which are absolutely required to have that particular feasibility over that financial control segment or not. So, this is will be like all related to the kind of internal control which will be required over your financial reporting. So, this particular section, that is 404, it focuses on the internal control over financial reporting. Number one thing that you need to keep in your mind is that management is required to produce an internal control report. Obviously, probably that's the only reason as to why the management is usually keen to appoint an internal auditor for their company. Though there is no such requirement for small size companies. Having said that, still, they prefer to involve the guidance and observation of an internal auditor. Why? Because they don't want any of the complication to arise at the later stage of statutory audit. So management is required to produce an internal control report as part of each annual Exchange Act report, which shall contain, number one, what is the responsibility of management? So, an affirmation on the responsibility of management for establishing and maintaining an adequate internal control structure and procedures for financial reporting. So, that's under the criteria of the responsibility of management. Number two, it will contain a statement, basically a statement which will be identifying the kind of framework which is used by the management to evaluate the internal controls. Number three, an assessment. Okay, after you prepare that statement, you need to go through an assessment as an end of the most recent fiscal year of the company of the effectiveness of the internal control structure and procedures of the issuer company for the financial reporting purpose. For this particular purpose, the internal control framework such as that described in COSO, just like I told you in my last presentation, so the kind of framework which was being quoted in that COSO is usually generally adopted. Accordingly, this report will also contain an evaluation by the management of material changes in their internal controls. What all are the different kind of material changes that have happened in the internal controls that will be stated, okay, on quarterly basis. Accordingly, the lastly thing will be the independent auditor's attestation report on management's assessment. Okay, so we as auditor are supposed to provide them the attestation report as to how the management has actually taken care of the assessment procedures. Did they completed the same in a very good manner? Okay, we'll be providing them the good kind of attestation report. But if in case there are some of the discrepancies over there, then in that case, we do need to provide our observation and recommendation for the same. So, it will contain the responsibility of management, the framework which is used by the management to evaluate the internal controls, an assessment of the internal control structure and procedures, evaluation by the management of material changes which have happened in the internal controls, and finally, the independent auditor's attestation report on the management's assessment. So, that is something which will happen as far as you will be following the Section 404 of the SOX Act. I hope each and every kind of example that I illustrated to you is pretty much clear. Perfect, guys. Let's move towards the management's responsibility now. So, what all will be included in the management's responsibility as far as this particular Section 404 of SOX Act is involved? Number one, the nature and characteristic of the company's use of information technology in the information system, which is going to affect the company's internal control over financial reporting. So, management will be responsible to take care of that nature and characteristic of the company's use of IT in that information system, with the help of which you are going to prepare all those financial reporting, or you'll be taking care of all those internal controls. So, management will be the person which will be taking care of the nature and the characteristic of all these use of IT in that particular area. Number two, CIO. By CIO, I simply mean the chief information officers of the company. These are the persons who are responsible for the security, accuracy, and reliability of the systems that manage and report the financial data. Let's suppose you have placed up any of the system in your company. Having said that, still that particular system is not an appropriate kind of system which should have been used in the company. So, usually in any kind of bigger enterprises, there is a CIO who is basically known as Chief Information Officer, like any other CEO, which is Chief Executive Officer and Chief Financial Officer. So, CIO is basically the person who is going to take care of all the IT issues for the company at the top level of management. Okay. So, he should be held as a responsible person to take care that whether the informations which have been like incorporated in the system, whatever are the changes which have been made with respect to the IT, are they like really secure? Are they accurate? Do they provide the reliable data? In that particular case, it is the responsibility of that CIO to take care of that. And CIO is who? He belongs to the management itself. Perfect. Next will be the ERP and other IT systems that are deeply integrated in initiating, authorizing, processing, and reporting of the financial data. As such, there have been like many instances wherein like inextricably linked to the overall financial reporting process. And this will need to be evaluated along with other important processes for compliance of SOX Act itself. So, in any kind of a company wherein you'll be working as an auditor, you may see that particular company is basically taking care of the ERP and other use of softwares. Okay, so it is always the responsibility of management to ensure that the ERP and IT systems that they are using for initiating, authorizing, and processing, and finally reporting the financial data, are they accurate enough? So, that will also be again considered in the management's responsibility. Then, coming back to the fourth point, SOX Act, basically, this signals a fundamental change in the business operations and financial reporting, and places responsibility in corporate financial reporting on Chief Executive Officer and Chief Financial Officer. The Chief Information Officer is also going to play a very significant role in the signing off of that financial statements. So, again, the signing off of the financial statements will be the primarily a responsibility of management. Okay, this management will include CEO, CFO, and CIO. So, they'll be taking care of the top letter of the position of that company. And lastly, CEC, that is the Securities Exchange Commission. Basically, this particular Securities Exchange Commission is going to identify the COSO framework by name as a methodology of for achieving compliance. So they'll ensure that whether the kind of COSO framework that the company is using for its methodology is it the kind of a good one, or like the correct one, apt one, which should have been used by the company or not. So again, this will form part of the management's responsibility to ensure that the CEAC kind of compliance, CEC compliance will be like taken care of perfectly well or not. So these are the kind of responsibilities which management has to ensure as far as the internal control systems are involved. This was all about the reporting certifications under Section 404 of SOX Act, and I'm sure that you guys got the complete clarity with respect to the same. Perfect, guys. Let's move to the next segment. So, this is about the meaning and purpose of the internal control over financial reporting. So, I just briefly told you about this thing. Okay, what does internal control over financial reporting mean by with the help of an example, with the help of a particular story? So now you'll be able to get it in a more clarity manner, wherein you'll get the complete enlightenment with this particular topic. So guys, what does internal control over financial reporting actually mean? So the internal control over financial reporting basically will include the kind of policies and procedures of the management that provide reasonable assurance about what? That whether the company is properly recording the purchases and sale of the company's assets or not, and whether those purchases and sale of the company's assets are properly maintained or not, number one. Second, they'll provide you the kind of policies and procedures of the management that will provide reasonable assurance that whether the transactions are properly recorded or not, so as to permit the preparation of the generally accepted financial statements. Again, these internal control over financial reporting are going to provide you a reasonable assurance that the receipt and the expenditures are being made in an authorized manner. And lastly, this internal control over financial reporting will also include those policies and procedures of the management that provide reasonable assurance that the unauthorized use of the company's asset that could have a material effect on the financial statements will be detected timely. So this is the role of internal control. People do ask me, sir, why internal control is very much required while going for forward towards preparation of the financial statements or taking care of the financial reporting. So this is because of this reason it is important. Why? Because this internal control will provide you the reasonable assurance that the kind of records the company is maintaining for purchase and sale of the company's assets are appropriate, transactions are properly recorded. Third, receipt and expenditures are being made in an absolutely authorized kind of a manner. And finally, the unauthorized use of the company's assets that could have a material effect on the financial statements can be detected timely and easily. So that's the meaning of internal control over financial reporting. I'm sure that you guys got the complete clarity with respect to each one of them. Now, moving towards the objective. So what is the objective of internal control over financial reporting? So this particular thing, internal control over financial reporting, is basically meant to ensure the integrity of the financial statements and guard the assets of the company in two major levels. Number one, book level, bookkeeping level, and second, the executive level. So they'll ensure one thing, that they are going to intact the integrity of the financial statements and guard the asset of the company at bookkeeping level and executive level. By bookkeeping level, I simply mean that they will enforce the proper recording of the income and expenditure. Okay, they'll ensure that the recording of income and expenditure is done in an appropriate manner so that the revenues are deposited into the company's bank account and the unauthorized expenditures do not leave the company's bank account at all. So they ensure that. And if I'll talk about the executive level, so what's the objective over here? So the objective will be to prevent the manipulation of revenues and expenses, such as illegal transfer from expense account to capital accounts, by which management may be tempted to show higher profits. So it will ensure that no such activity is going to take place wherein unnecessary profits are booked upon or revenues are excessively generated. So that will be considered in a sham company kind of stuff. So this will be the way wherein internal controls over financial reporting will help the company in protecting its integrity with respect to the financial statements and guard its asset at bookkeeping level and executive level. I'm sure you guys got the complete clarity with respect to objectives as well. Perfect. Let's move towards the purpose now. So, what is the purpose of having the internal control over financial reporting? Number one, sampling and random test check. Okay, so guys, we all are aware of this thing that you and me as an auditor, we don't have much time. Okay, so that's one of the inherent limitations of any of the audit. Our audit basically starts with deadline in our mind. We need to complete that particular thing within that stipulated time so that we can provide our company. Maybe it's a big four, maybe it's another mediocre kind of company. So we need to provide them our results in a timely manner. So in this particular case, we usually resort towards any of the sampling measures or random test check, which are usually done by a statutory auditor, is justified only if in case a reliable system of internal control over financial reporting is available. So if in case there will be a very good kind of a system, and we are all aware of this fact that the kind of a system which the company has placed in its premises, it's extremely well and it can be a bit relied upon as far as the internal control over financial reporting is concerned. So in that case is the statutory auditor can go for the estimate on the basis of sampling and random test check as well, only and only if in case a reliable system of internal control over financial reporting is available. Number one. Number two, the establishment, maintenance and periodic evaluation of internal control over financial reporting is extremely important from the point of view of audit of financial statements, since it provides a level of comfort that the checks and balances which monitor the day-to-day financial operations of the company are appropriately complied with and done. So hence this particular internal control over financial reporting is important. Why? Because it's going to help you up with the kind of establishment, maintenance and periodic evaluation stuff which will help in with the point of view of the audit of financial statements. Number three, if in case no reliable internal control over financial reporting exists in the company, then in that case, you as an auditor have to confirm and conduct the test of transactions and perform additional analysis in order to accumulate sufficient evidence to support your opinion on the financial statements. So you need to go and dig down a bit more deeper in that case. And since I'm talking about the test of transactions, so you need to get into the now transactions, each and every kind of bigger transaction or the transaction which basically ask you for a questioning mind to ask and to maintain that professional skepticism all the way. So if in case there is no reliable IC over FR which exists in the company, then perform those test of transactions and perform those additional analysis. That's all about the meaning and purpose of internal control over financial reporting. I hope you guys got the complete clarity with respect to this important topic as well. Perfect guys, with this let's move towards the next topic. And that will be, what about the duties of management to assess and report on company's IC over FR? By IC over FR, I simply mean internal controls over financial reporting. So what all are the duties of management to assess and report on the company's IC over FR? Number one, to evaluate the effectiveness of control and report. That should be the number one task. Okay, the company has maintained some of the internal controls. You have set up a company. Okay, so you must have like deployed some of the internal controls to ensure that everything is going fine with that company, right? As an employer. Perfect. Then in that case, whenever the auditor comes in, auditor will check this thing, whether the company is taking care of all the things or not. But before auditor taking up all these assignments and check basis, okay, it is the responsibility of management to evaluate whether the kind of controls and report controls they have like implemented in the system, are they effective enough to take care of any of the material misstatement happening anytime again in future or not. So it has to be taken care of. So the first responsibility of management is to ensure the reliability of internal control over financial reporting at all times. The management is required to evaluate the effectiveness of the controls on periodic basis and to include a report of such evaluation in the annual report, which must be attested by the company's external auditor. By external auditor, I simply mean the statutory auditors. That should be the number one duty of management. Number two, disclosure of material weakness in the report. If in case management did evaluated the effectiveness of the control. Okay, you did that. Okay, perfect. Now, if in case in the course of that particular evaluation, the management discovers that there is some certain deficiency in the system of operation or of that particular internal control over financial reporting, that could actually adversely affect a company's ability to record, process, summarize, and report the financial data consistent with the assertions of the management in the company's financial statement, then in that case, the management must disclose the material weakness in its report. It's extremely important, okay, guys, to check out and pen down the kind of material weaknesses that you encountered during that particular stuff at the right note of time, so that prevention can be done at the right time. So that's number two responsibility. Number three, the compliance with 404 of SOX Act. Obviously, we did had a discussion about this section 404, and we all are now aware of the fact that how important is this particular section. So this particular rule requires that quarterly evaluation of only those controls which have changed and which have that been like materially affected or are reasonably likely to materially affect the company's internal control over financial reporting. So they should be kept under the radar, and accordingly it is the responsibility of management to check the compliance of this particular section. So it's extremely important, and the same is required that way. So these are the duties of management to assess and report on the company's IC over FR, evaluate the effectiveness of the controls and report on that. Next, disclosure of material weakness in the report if in case you find any. And finally, you need to comply with the section 404 of SOX Act 2002. I'm sure that you guys got the complete clarity with respect to the duties of management as well. Perfect. Let's move towards the key areas covered by Auditing Standard 2 of PACAO. So before moving on to the key areas which have been like covered under Auditing Standard 2 of PACAO, let's understand what does this Auditing Standard 2 of PACAO actually like discusses. What all things that particular act, the standard discuss. So it basically discusses about an audit of internal controls over financial reporting, which are being performed in conjunction with an audit of the financial statements itself. This standard is basically a kind of sequel. If I'll talk about, okay, if the section 404 is the primary movie, the starting franchisee, okay, so in that particular case, this standard is going to be a sequel to section 404 of SOX Act. Okay, this basically addresses a few areas, okay, which will require to be covered under Auditing Standard 2 of PACAO. Number one, design of controls. Okay, so the relevant assertions which are related to all the significant accounts and disclosures in the financial statements will be covered under this particular design of controls. Number two, information on significant transactions. Okay, so information about how the significant transactions are initiated, authorized, supported, processed, and finally reported. You need to have that auditory, okay, you need to have that mindset with which you can extract the information on all the kind of significant transactions. How are these transactions being processed, guys? Okay, how are the authorized? Okay, perfect. How are they supported? Is there a person who is preparing the same? Okay, in that case, and finally, how they are reported? All these questions which need to remain, and you need to ask these questions frequently in order to ensure that you guys are delivering your duty as an auditor all the time. Number two was information on significant transactions. Number three, adequate information about the flow of transactions. So adequate information is always required in order to ensure that you correctly identify the flow of transactions, to identify where material misstatements can happen due to error or fraud could actually occur. So it's extremely important to have the adequate information with respect to the flow of transactions. Number four is the controls. So the controls which are designed to prevent and detect fraud. This will include the ones who perform the controls and the regulated segregation of duties as well. Let's suppose in a bank you may go. Okay, I'll talk about simply about the bank. Okay, and you are taking about checking of the cash over there. Okay, and you find that there is some embezzlement which has happened. Okay, and the cashier is like having no idea about the same. So are you like going to disturb the MD of that bank as well? Are you? Absolutely not. You'll be discussing the matter first of all with that cashier, because he is the person who is taking care of that. Okay, So the controls which are designed to prevent and detect the fraud, you need to have an idea and the complete knowledge with that person first of all, okay? And if in case, this particular thing will help you in understanding the segregation of duties, who all are the person who will be like involved in this, okay? And then you'll move towards the higher management. So this thing will also help you up in segregating the duties, okay? So if the cash is embezzled, so that will be considered under the duty of cashier or head cashier. So they are the best persons who can take care of it. They'll be the first person who will be questioned in that case. Next, the controls over the period in financial reporting process. Okay, so the controls which are designed to prevent and detect fraud, that has already been covered. Next will be the controls over period end financial reporting process. Usually what happens during the month end, we always, almost many of the people who are working with the corporates, they usually tend to tell you, okay, dude, why are you actually getting late nowadays? You're coming back from the office quite late. So they usually say, dude, month end is going on, so I can't help. Okay, so what does that month end? Okay, so that is this. There has been like a period end on which financial reporting does happen for any of the organization. For most of the organization, it's on monthly basis or quarterly basis, or maybe for a smaller companies, that's on yearly basis. So this will include some of the controls. Okay, so what all controls are required to ensure that the period end financial reporting process goes on smoothly and in an appropriate fashion? So it needs to be covered under these key areas as well. Moving on to the control over safeguarding of assets. So you need to ensure that the assets are properly guarded. Okay, there has been like taking care of a provision who is basically taking care of all the safeguarding of assets. So the controls which are formed for safeguarding of assets, that will also be covered into the key area. And then finally, concluding with the results of management's testing and evaluation. This is also something which will be covered under the key area covered by the auditing standard 2 of PCAO. What all are the results of management's testing and evaluation? Design and controls, information on significant transactions, adequate information about the flow of transactions, controls designed to prevent and detect fraud, controls over the period end financial reporting process, controls over safeguarding of assets, and finally, results of the management's testing and evaluation. I hope you guys got the complete clarity with respect to each and every relevant topic that I discussed with you, whether it was about the duties of management to assess and report the company's IC over FR, or it was about key areas covered by the auditing standard 2 of PCAO. Perfect guys, let's move towards the next topic. So what all are the list of procedures that are required to be followed by management in preparing the report of the effectiveness of internal control over financial reporting? Since you are taking care as an auditor, you have been appointed to check out the effectiveness of the IC over FR. So you need to implement some of the procedures, okay? And while implementing those, you need to assess the procedures which have been like followed by the management also in preparing the report for that effectiveness of IC over FR. So what all are the list of procedures that will be done by the management in that case? Number one is the scope of management review. By the management review, I simply mean that management should review the company's control. Control relating to, number one, what's happening when the FR process begins. Obviously, you need to initiate it. Okay, so initiating, recording, then moving on to processing, and then finally reconciling all the account balances, classes of transactions, disclosures, and related assertions included in the financial statements. That should be the number one priority. Okay, so management need to review the company's control with respect to this particular thing. Next will be the initiation and processing of the non-routine and non-systematic transactions. Many of the times we see, okay, the company has provided for some of the expenses, okay, which are usually not recurring in nature. We have seen that only once in a year that happens to be the case, wherein the company is willing to pay that non-routine expenses. Okay, so you need to understand how that particular initiation took place. Okay, who were the persons who were like involved in processing that, and who were the persons who like authorized it. Okay, so initiation and processing of non-routine and non-systematic transactions. Moving on to selection and application of appropriate accounting policies. The company is preparing the financial statements. Okay, certainly in that case, the company would be like adopting the usage of some of the accounting policies. Obviously, it has to. So you need to assess that. Okay, how the company came to a conclusion that we are going to select this particular accounting policy, or this particular accounting policy. So, selection and application of the appropriate accounting policy will also be covered under the scope of management review. And finally, the prevention, identification and detection of fraud. That's something which I don't need to tell you any of the time. So, it is under the scope of management review itself that they need to assess whether there are some of the chances of prevention, identification or detection of some fraud which has been going on over there or not. This was about the first point, that is the scope of management review. Moving on to the framework. So guys, by framework, I simply want to tell you one thing, that the Securities Exchange Commission, okay, has not mandated any of the particular framework for the evaluation of the effectiveness of the IC over FR. Okay, they have kept the choice very much open. You can, as a management of the company, you can willfully adopt any of the framework. Okay. However, having said that, the framework used must be, number one, free from any of the bias. Okay. So, that should be free from any of the bias. Okay. Number one. Number two, that should be relevant to the evaluation of IC. Your main job over here is to check out the effectiveness of IC over FR. So, accordingly, technically, it should be relevant to the evaluation of IC. Number three, it should permit qualitative as well as quantitative measurements, which is obviously required. Many of the framework usually provides for something which provides you about quantitative measurement, but there needs to be the adoption of any of the framework which also provides you something with related to qualitative aspect and measurements as well. And finally, that particular framework should be like sufficiently complete to include all those factors that would include alter any of the conclusion about its effectiveness. So these are the characteristics with which you can choose any of the good framework in order to ensure that internal control over financial reporting. Moving on to the third point, that is the methods. So the Securities Exchange Commission rules do not specify any of the method, just like framework. They also do not specify any of the method or procedures which are required to be performed in an evaluation, since these methods will vary, obviously, from one company to another. However, having said that, they require the management to maintain the documentation. Obviously, the management needs to maintain those documentation that supports its assessment on the effectiveness of the company's IC over FR. So, there is no particular kind of a method which you need to imply and comply with. SEC has basically, like, again, left this choice also open. You can opt and specify any of the method, whichever you wish to. Since accordingly they know that there will be different kind of companies will be working in that arena, so this particular stuff will also vary from company to company. All they require is that the management should maintain the documentation that supports the assessment of the effectiveness of the company's IC over FR. Number four, about documentation. So what does documentation will include over here? Documentation regarding the design of internal controls and testing process should provide a reasonable support. For what? Number one, for the evaluation whether the control is designed to prevent and detect the material misstatement or omissions or not. Number two, they'll support for the conclusion that the tests were appropriately planned and performed. Number three, they'll provide support that the results of the tests were appropriately considered. All these things will be documented. Again, that is why it is being included in this particular list. And finally, after documentation of all these three things, you'll proceed towards the reporting segment. So, the company's annual report should include an internal control report of management that contains a few of the matters. Okay, number one, a statement of management's responsibility for establishing and maintaining the IC over FR. Number two, a statement which will identify the framework which is used by the management to conduct that required evaluation. What was the framework which was used? What was the management's responsibility statement? Both these things need to be included. Number three, the management's assessment of effectiveness of the company's internal control over financial reporting as of at the end of the company's most recent fiscal year, which the assessment must include disclosure of any material weakness in the company's internal control over financial reporting which is identified by the management. So, this assessment will be covered in that. And finally, a statement of that the audit firm basically that is going to audit the financial statements has included in the annual report has issued a attestation report. Okay, I just discussed with you in my last slide that that attestation report is extremely important. So that will be provided by the auditor on management's assessment of the company's IC over FR, which report must be filed as a part of the company's annual report with the Securities Exchange Commission. Henceforth, it is extremely important in that sense. So what all were the list of procedures that were required to be followed by the management in preparing the report for the effectiveness of the IC over FR? Number 1, scope of management review. Number 2, framework. Number 3, methods. Number 4, documentation. And then finally, concluding towards the reporting. I hope each and every kind of example that I briefly narrated to you has been like completely understood from your end as well. Perfect guys, let's move towards the next topic of the day, and that will be about the role. Your role now. There is something that I need to tell you, something about your role now. Okay. All of a while I was just discussing with you about the management's role. Okay. So any of your father who has like a good kind of a company and you are included in the management of that, okay, I'll give you a thumbs up for that. So all this part which I did covered in my last slide, till my last slide, that will be for you guys. But if in case you want to become a particular CA and you are working as a statutory auditor in any of your audit company, okay, so now there is something for you. So what is the role of the external auditor's opinion with respect to the effectiveness of the company's IC over FR? Obviously you need to know. So number 1, that will be your opinion. So guys, as per the Securities Exchange Commission rules, each annual report should include an attestation by the company's external auditor, that means stat auditor, in which the audit firm expresses an opinion or states that the opinion cannot be expressed about the management's assessment of the effectiveness of the company's internal control over financial reporting in accordance with the standards and engagement attestations. SOX basically requires the PACAUB to establish standards for people for these attestation reports as well. So this is something which needs to be done. So this will be done in this auditor's opinion. Now, moving on to auditor cannot monitor controls. Okay, so this is basic heading. Now, with this, what do we understand? That auditor cannot monitor controls. So this is something that management cannot delegate the evaluation of the internal control or financial reporting to the company's external auditors. The company's management cannot delegate. Obviously, it is not our responsibility to evaluate the internal control over financial reporting. It is the management's responsibility. So they cannot delegate in that particular case, since the SEC rules of auditor independence, one of them has been like prohibited under the non-audit services that the external auditor may not provide to its audit client in its monitoring of the internal controls. That is something which is basically will be depending upon another form of a person. But the management cannot delegate the effectiveness of evaluation of the effectiveness of the internal control of financial reporting. Number 2, that will be about the role of assessment. What is the basic role in assessment which will be involved in this particular case? So under section 404 of SOX Act, the external auditor must attest to the effectiveness of the management's evaluation of the internal controls. The external auditor must be involved in that assessment. Keep that in mind. And finally, number 3, evaluation of IC. So management must be actively involved in the evaluation of the IC and coordinate the process with external auditors. So that's how it's going to be done. So that is about the role of external auditor with respect to any of his opinion with the about the effectiveness of the company's IC over FR. He or she will provide the auditor's opinion, and the auditor cannot monitor control. It is the responsibility of management, which has been like dealt with the basic points: non-delegation of monitoring of IC, role in assessment and evaluation of IC. I hope you guys got the complete clarity with respect to your role as far as an auditor is concerned. Now let's move to the last topic of this SOX Act. That will be about the arguments. Okay, now we'll have this debate. Okay, get ready. Sit on the edge of your chairs. Okay, you need to be on either side. Okay, I have like taught you and made you understand each and every kind of topic with respect to this SOX Act. So are you guys in favor of that, or are you guys against the implementation of SOX? Tell me one way. Definitely, don't worry guys, I'll provide you the brief instances and the kind of arguments with both the scenarios. I'll start with against first. So all those people who are against the SOX Act implementation, three cheers to you. Hip hip hooray. Number one, what all are the arguments with respect to the SOX Act implementation? Number one, that more compliance verification will be required to be done. This process is going to be like cumbersome, guys. Obviously, it requires more addition of the work which is required to be done by the auditors. So more compliance verification needs to be done by the auditor. And hence, there will be a huge time and cost which will be involved in this particular audit. Okay, this will increase. So that is something for the persons who basically wish that this particular thing is against, they are against the SOX Act implementation. So number one thing is due to the cost, time involved, and more compliance factor. Number two, the small and medium enterprises. Okay, so guys, they have to spend much amount and on this SOX implementation. Obviously, you basically start up any of a company. Okay, you don't have much funds to engage your business for a longer period of time. And if someone asks you up, okay, dude, why are you not implementing the SOX in your business? You'll say, come on, dude, get a life. I'm here to run a business. Are you really asking me to implement the SOX for that? Please. So in that case, the SMEs have to spend a lot of amount in SOX implementation and compliance, which is basically financially prohibited for them. Okay. Number three, the purchase of compliance software and implementing the recognized COSO framework will also include higher cost. Okay. You need to have those softwares. You need to have that COSO framework which has been recognized. That will also include some of the higher cost. Number three, much of the top level executives' time will be spent on more and more documentation, testing, walkthrough of the SOX implementation and compliance. And thus, this will lead to a loss of management's productivity. Obviously, again, you need to hire another personnel. Okay. Or if in case you won't be resorting towards the hiring of another personnel, then in that case, you have to suffer on the quality which a person is actually providing you. Why? Because you have allocated a few more tasks on him. So, that is going to affect the management's productivity. And then finally, many corporates transfer their stock exchange from NASDAQ to London Stock Exchange, where regulations are comparatively less. So this is a very clear case. It has actually happened, guys, because since this thing was involved first of all in USA, so many of the people usually changed and transferred their stock exchanges. Why? Because a huge amount of compliance was being done. So say they just shifted from NASDAQ to London Stock Exchange in order to ensure that they don't need to have any of the SOX Act implementation done for their company. So these are the arguments which are being based in against of SOX Act implementation. I hope you guys got the complete clarity who all were being involved in the team which was against the SOX Act implementation. Three cheers to you guys. Perfect, guys. Now, with the persons who are in favor of the SOX Act implementation, kindly raise your hand over there in the front of video itself. Number one, why you will be in favor? I'll tell you. Number one, that there will be a greater corporate transparency. The same will be achieved. So you can get the benefit of greater corporate transparency. Number two, the financial statements and forecasts which will be made will be a bit more reliable. You guys are much more concerned about the transparency and the kind of fairness of the financial statements. So if you will be implementing the SOX, then in that case, the financial statements and the forecast will be made in a bit more reliable manner. Number three, that the overall increase will happen in the investor's wealth. Why? Because since the financial reporting is done in a very accurate manner, so you'll be able to provide the best kind of detailing for each of your profits, revenues, cost, and each everything. So in that case, if in case you'll be not implementing the SOX implementation, there are chances that the investor's wealth is going to get disturbed or hampered due to that. But if you'll implement it, then in that case, the overall increase will happen in the investor's wealth. Number four, this will actually boost the investor's confidence. Okay, I am, let's suppose I'm an investor, you are an investor. Okay, we've got two of the companies in front of our eyes now. Okay, one company is having SOX implementation done, one company is against it. Okay, they are not favoring that. Both the companies are having the same kind of records. Okay, what do you think you'd favor choose which one of them? Obviously, the one which is in favor of it. Both the companies are providing the same kind of result. Both the companies are providing each and every kind of same trust. But the only thing is, since they were in favor of SOX implementation, they have also got their audit done by the SOX auditor as well. So there will be, again, this will increase the investor's confidence. And finally, more effective coordination with external auditors will help in resulting in high quality of audit work. So again, that is something which is in favor of SOX Act implementation. I hope you guys got the complete clarity with respect to the arguments, either in favor of SOX implementation or against the SOX implementation. Perfect, guys. With this, I conclude this chapter completely, and I hope that you guys got the each and every kind of concept that I ever wanted to deliver to you. Perfect. I'll conclude my video with a dose of motivation, and that will be that God helps those who help themselves. This quote is being mentioned by a person who is named Anonymous. Obviously, Anonymous is a person. I just don't know about the person who quoted this quote. So this is something which I am reading from my childhood. Okay. So this is something which gives me a boost whenever I tend to go for any of the option in my life. So it is always the risk taker. Okay. It is always the person who tends to make decisions right at the right moment of time. Then only things will happen in their favor. So God helps those who help themselves. If you want to achieve something in life, you need to help yourself first of all. Don't rely on the God completely. Almighty is there to take care of all of us. I do second the thought, but certainly he or she is the person who is going to take care of only those who are willing to help themselves. So you need to help yourself first of all, and then only you can expect that God is going to take care of you. Perfect, guys. Do revise your topic time and again, because that's the most crucial thing. Once you'll be right revising this topic, this particular SOX Act will be on your tips, believe me. So all you need to do is just revise that. Thank you on behalf of Edupedia World.